Tombstone, Arizona, an 1880s silver mining boom town. Today, the town that is too tough to die still thrives. In its heyday, shootings, murders, and mayhem became common. Saloons and dance halls were open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The violence in Tombstone would peak with the gunfight at the OK Corral. This now world-famous gunfight will leave 3 men dead, forever to remain in Tombstone. Do the tormented spirits of those killed in Tombstone still walk the streets? Is Tombstone haunted? Join us now as we investigate the supernatural. Ghosts of Tombstone. In 1877, a prospector named Edward Lawrence Shefflin would find silver in the hills near the present-day city. Remembering the warning of the soldiers in the area that the only thing he would find in the hills of Apache country was his tombstone, Ed named his first mine the Tombstone. He died on May 12, 1897 in Oregon. His last wish was to be buried on the granite hills west of the city of Tombstone, in a prospector's outfit with a pick and canteen, with a monument such as a prospector would build over a claim to be built over his gravesite. On May 23, 1897, Ed Shefflin was laid to rest, the largest funeral in Tombstone history. News of a mountain of silver would bring people from around the country to place mining claims. The city of Tombstone was named after Ed's first mine. The population in the city of Tombstone would soar as thousands flocked to the city with dreams of riches. The Crystal Palace would be just one of 110 licensed saloons to sell liquor in Tombstone, and one of the most popular. The Earp brothers had a gambling interest in the Oriental Saloon and could often be found there. In 1882, the New York Times referred to the Birdcage Theater as the wildest, wickedest night spot between Basin Street and the Barbary Coast. Once opened, the Birdcage never closed its doors, operating 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 9 straight years. Tombstone attracted some of the deadliest gunmen in the West. For a time, gunfights became a common occurrence on the streets and in the saloons of Tombstone. One of the best-known gunfights in Western history occurred here at the OK Corral. The town began to run into trouble as the cost of silver began to drop and the silver mines became flooded with water. The population dropped to a few hundred residents, and Tombstone almost became a Western ghost town. Today, Tombstone is thriving as a popular tourist location. The Birdcage Theater was boarded up for almost 50 years. Today, it houses many artifacts from around the town. Many of the buildings in Tombstone were built in the 1880s, like the City Hall and the Old Courthouse. The history of events in Tombstone have made it world famous. Has this history of good times and bad caused some building or locations to become haunted? Let's start our supernatural investigation of some of Tombstone's most haunted locations. During this investigation, we will be taking photographs and shooting videotape. On photos, we are looking for anomalies or orbs. Here are orbs in a photo. Our video camera shoots in infrared. We are looking for orbs that move through the infrared beam, like this one. It is thought among paranormal groups that orbs are energy. They usually take the form of a round, dense object. They are usually white, but can be other colors. Now that we have seen the basics, let's go start our investigations. Hi, I'm Gloria with Ghost Trackers. We are here at the Buford House Bed and Breakfast, which is listed on the National Register of Historic Places in Tombstone, Arizona. Let's go in and meet the proprietors.
We've had several theories on what happens here. One of them is that there was a young man here living with his father. The young man was named George Dawes. He was 21. He's from Santa Clara County, California. And young George was in love with a girl across the street named Cleopatra Edmonds. Her pet name was Petra. So young George and Cleopatra had what they called a Victorian understanding. The parents had met, given the approval to the relationship, but they weren't actually engaged yet. There was no ring, there was no initial bordering on the linen. You know, it was just an understanding. We're a steady item and, you know, we're preparing for marriage. So in that preparation for marriage, George goes to a mine 40 miles this side of Casa Grande. Young George works there about 9 months, we think, comes back on a Tuesday. Cleopatra goes across the street to Cleopatra. They exchange greetings, says hello to her mom. And Cleopatra assures him that we're still on and so forth. So on Tuesday, a group of young people goes out visiting. George and Cleopatra are among them. They visit several people, and to George's disappointment, she accepts the arm of another man going home. This sends George into a deep depression. He comes home, he's very despondent. His father's quite concerned on him. I'm sure they talked about, you know, girls do this, it's, you know, don't take too much to heart. You know, you've been gone for 9 months, maybe, you know, maybe she's still too young for marriage, maybe she needs to think about it some more. So the next morning, father gets up. George is still in the clothes that he had on the night before, having not slept, still very despondent and not himself. The father thinks he'll check on him at noon when he comes home from lunch. George greeted his father coming home at lunch, looked out the window, saw Cleopatra talking to a young man at her gate. So the father hangs up his gun belt at the doorway, goes in and hangs up his coat, and on his way hanging up his coat, he hears his son say, "Goodbye, father." So being concerned about the young man, he follows him. On the way from hanging up the coat to the door, there are 4 shots. He opens the door to see George put the 5th one through his head and Cleopatra bleeding in front of her garden gate.
Cleopatra survives being shot near the front of her house. George dies in the middle of the street. We're currently on the 2nd floor of the Buford House Bed and Breakfast in Tombstone, Arizona. This is one of the most active rooms in the house. We've currently set up some infrared cameras throughout the house, and I'll be monitoring those downstairs. We've vacated the house. There's no one in the house except for me and a few other people. We'll be roaming through the house using flashlights with red lenses to be able to see in the dark without turning any lights on. We're trying to detect any further activity that will occur in these rooms. We've also set up temperature sensors here and in the various rooms that will show me if there's any temperature fluctuations going on. We'll also be taking EMF readings and listening for any amplified sounds, muffles, voices, cries, anything that we can pick up using audio equipment as well. Now let's go take a look at the monitors. Our equipment was set up just outside. Before I begin to watch the monitors, I took pictures of where George had killed himself. Notice the orbs in the pictures of the street. We had a few infrared cameras monitoring different rooms in the house. The view on the left was filmed at night with infrared. The right side was filmed during the day. Watch this orb fly past the camera. Watch inside the box. And again with no box. Do you think that was a bug? On the left, a moth. On the right, the orb. The moth. The orb, no comparison.
Last year at this time, during hunting season, we had a young man with his son that stayed up into the western room, which is the closest to the bedroom or to the stairway here. And About 3 o'clock in the morning, he heard a young man and a woman arguing at the base of the stairs. And so he was very noisily getting up, you know, made a lot of noise so people would hear him, but not waking up the other guests. Well, he opened the door and poked his head around the corner and looked down the stairwell. He didn't see anything because he figured, well, they heard him get up and he stopped, you know, and they stopped arguing. So he went back to bed, and about 45 minutes later, he heard the man and woman argue again. So this time he was very quiet, opened the door gently and very quietly, poked his head around the corner of where his door was, and looked down the stairwell, and he didn't see a man or a woman, but he could still hear them arguing, man, you know, woman and man, and they just kept it up for about 2 or 3 minutes, and then they stopped.
Some of the most incredible activity happened in one of the lower bedrooms. Watch the orbs at the lower right. Miss it? Watch in the box. And one more time. In the same room, two orbs move toward the camera. Watch inside the box. And again, two orbs. During the investigation, I walked around taking a few more photos. This photo was taken of the dresser in a lower bedroom. Look at the mirror. Several faces appear in the mirror. So, in conclusion, do I think that the Buford House is haunted? I don't think that there's anything in this world that would make me believe otherwise. Through all the experiences and looking back on all the pictures and all the video, I believe that there is something in that house. On October 26th, 1881, the most famous gunfight in Western history took place near the back gate of the OK Corral. The lawmen consisted of Wyatt Earp, Virgil Earp, Morgan Earp, and Doc Holliday. The cowboys consisted of Ike Clanton, his brother Billy, Tom McLowry, and Frank McLowry. The fight between the Earps and the Clantons and McLowrys took place between Fly's photo gallery and the now long gone Harwood House. The fight would start in the area in the box, but quickly spill into the street. The fight would end with the deaths of Billy Clanton, Frank McLowry, and Tom McLowry. All three are buried at Boot Hill Cemetery. We start our investigation at the front of the OK Corral. Watch the shadow at the top of the screen. Look in the box. And again, see the shadow. We next move to the area of the actual shootout on Fremont Street. On this night, there was very little paranormal activity. On the night of March 18th, 1882, Wyatt and Morgan Earp were at the Campbell and Hatch Saloon. Morgan was shot and killed while playing pool at the saloon. The pool table was located under the skylight. We found no activity at the front of the Campbell and Hatch Saloon. The town of Tombstone would be the location of numerous shootings and murders. Allen Street would be the location of many of these shootings before the Birdcage Theater was built. Curly Bill Brocious accidentally shot Marshal Fred White at this location. Marshal Fred White is buried at Boot Hill. another shooting took place at the front of the Oriental Saloon. Buckskin Frank Leslie killed Billy Claiborne. Billy is buried at Boot Hill. We walked around town shooting video and taking photographs for this investigation. We checked out historic buildings like Tombstone's City Hall and Shefflin Hall. Although we were unsuccessful at capturing activity on film, there were feelings of a presence while in town. The historic Birdcage Theater. In its heyday, numerous shootings and murders took place within its walls. The owners of the Birdcage allowed the ghost trackers the opportunity to spend the night inside to investigate the paranormal activity. We started our setup by running video cables to our three infrared cameras set up around the building. Next, we place temperature sensors around the building and linked them all to our control panel. Electromagnetic field sensors were placed around the building and set to make an audible alarm if the field changed. We placed a Geiger counter near the stage. With all of our equipment now placed around the inside of the Birdcage Theater, it's time to start monitoring activities at our control panel.
My name is Paula Jean Reed. I've been in Tombstone 14 years. I have been connected with the Birdcage for the entire time of 14 years. And I worked in the building every day for several years from the very beginning. The things that happen in this building, you either have to say, well, I'm losing my mind, or you have to put it on something that there is maybe the energies, the spirits, the things that make things happen around here. I think my first experience was putting something down and it disappearing. You can't find it anywhere, and you leave and you come back and it reappears in the same place where you knew you had put it. Next thing that really took me away or got me excited was we have the old polyphone in the lobby. And on several occasions, we had to wind it because people would take the token and play it. And several times during the day this would happen, and I never knew when it was gonna happen, because you would open the door and there was nothing. And then without any forewarning or anything, you could open the door and it was like a really strange smell. On the top, on the backstage of the Birdcage, there is a tub with the claw feet, and we've had several reports that people walk in on the backstage, this lilac perfume that you would associate with the 1880s. Walking through the thermal climbs, I guess, where it's warm, you walk through, you take a step and it's like 20 degrees cooler. You definitely can feel it. You can just walk right through it. You can stand in it and put your hand out and feel a warmer air than what your body is feeling because you're standing in it. That happens through this building all the time. The employees that have worked in this building, when we get some that really get scared and they leave, they don't work here very long. Like the lady that cleaned one time, and she got very upset because she would sweep, she would move a chair and sweep and continue sweeping around the floor. And she'd go back to put the chair back and the chair would be moved. Another lady that cleaned reported being pinched in the building. there was a lady that worked in the gift shop, and she became very confused because she could understand, she would see out of the corner of her eye these three cowboys come out of the window at the gift shop. There's a window there that goes into Sadie's bordello bedroom. And these three cowboys would just kind of lean out, and she would catch them with the corner of her eye. When she turned, they were gone. One of the loudest and biggest things that happened that really took me back, we were doing a documentary in the building one night, and the gentleman that was filming wanted to film in Sadie's room. So we were down in the basement unscrewing the door and getting it open so that he could get the equipment in there and get the reenactor, the actor in there to do the reenactment. And while I'm doing that, they were all up on the main body of the building. And the minute I opened that door, Red River Valley, I'll never forget, that song blared like it was turned on in the main part of the building, and it blared so loud all the way down to the basement, like it was just like running over you. I couldn't believe it. I turned and ran up the stairs and ran to see what was going on, what had happened, because I knew that our entire sound system was shut down, so it wasn't coming from us, and we don't even have that music in this building. And then I was thinking, well, maybe our sound system had picked up something else in town or something. And I immediately, when I arrived into the main body, the people that were going to be in the reenactment and the gentleman that was filming were standing there, and I said, who did that? Because I thought maybe he did it with his camera, his sound system, or whatever. And he just looked at me and said, what? And I said, that noise, the Red River Valley, the song that ran through this building like it was just a rush of a hurricane or a force of air. And he says, I didn't hear anything. Now, everybody else did hear it. And so I thought, well, you didn't do it? And he said, I didn't hear anything. He would never admit that he heard it. There was a couple that visited the birdcage, and they took a picture of Fatima's painting in the lobby of the birdcage. They sent us a copy of it, and when they developed the picture in Fatima's dress, there was a face that appeared. You can look at Fatima's painting all day long, and you're not going to see the face. It is definitely in the picture, and it's really, that is very interesting.
During our setup on the backstage area, our 35mm camera began to malfunction. The camera began to autofocus while just sitting on a tripod. Our videotape also became distorted during filming. Listen to the camera. Listen again. In the main room, strange things started to occur, mostly with the 35mm camera. The camera took 16 photos by itself. No one was touching any of the controls. Here are the 16 photos in sequence. Here in the main room of the Birdcage Theater, dance hall girl and lady of the evening, Gold Dollar, murdered another girl for flirting with her man, Billy Milgreen. Margarita was a new girl in town and was attempting to win over Billy. Gold Dollar had warned Margarita to stay away from her man. When she heard that Margarita was with Billy again, she confronted her in the birdcage. Gold Dollar stabbed Margarita and attempted to cut her heart out. Covered in blood, Gold Dollar ran out of the back of the Birdcage Theater and left town with Billy. Margarita is buried at Boot Hill Cemetery. At our station, we log information into our laptop computer.
My name is Leroy Colomy. I'm known as Lightning Leroy here in Tombstone, and I am the manager here at the famous Birdcage Theater in Tombstone. I arrived in Tombstone in early 1991. I've been here now for over 12 years, and I have worked here at the Birdcage for Mr. Hunley now for 8 years. And I have, in the time that I've been here at the Birdcage, have witnessed several strange phenomena that go on in this old building. Some of my own experiences that I've had is on the lower floor where the crap table is. You can walk into that, up to that crap table and walk right into an ice cold spot and then smell real strong cigar smoke. At one time, when I walked up to that table and I felt that cold feeling and the cigar smoke was real, real strong, and then I was actually tapped on the shoulder. I turned to look and reach, there was nobody there. And it was like somebody telling me, excuse me, you're in my spot at that table. So I slowly moved away and made my way to the backstage stairs. No longer could smell that smoke. There are times, one other time when I was having an interview right here where I'm sitting with Mr. Hunley with another network. And we had a new gal that had just started working in our gift shop downstairs. When the interview was going on, I went and got her and brought her over to the foot of the stairs so that she could hear Mr. Hunley, because he's very knowledgeable about this building. And while I was talking with her at the foot of the stairs, I was hit from behind. You know, somebody would play a joke on you and hit your knee out from under you. Actually took me down to one knee. And she looked at me like, what's the matter with you? I said, somebody's here? Somebody hit me from behind. But of course, nobody was there. I've never had a sighting myself, but I've had these strange things happen to me here in this building. And it gets quite spooky at times, I'm here to tell you. We do have reported 26 resident ghosts here, and they're all quite friendly ghosts. We've had no harm has come to anybody. So they all seem to be quite friendly that are here. We do have one that has been seen over 100 times right here on the backstage. He was a stagehand that worked here in the 1880s. He's seen many times walking stage left to stage right, and he just walks right out of sight. And he wears a pair of striped pants, a white shirt, a visor, and carrying a clipboard. And he's been sighted, like I said, over 100 times. We had an employee working downstairs in the gift shop, and it was time to close, and she watches the monitors in the building, so before she closes up, she'll check the building on the monitors, make sure there's nobody left inside. And she got ready to close, and on the monitor she saw a woman in a white dress down there in the poker room, so which is right around the corner from the gift shop. So she walked around to go tell her that we were closing and that she would have to leave. And as she got there, this woman walked right on through into the wine cellar, through the bars, and just disappeared out of sight. And this employee was white herself by the time she got up front to tell what she had seen. And there was nobody there, you know.
After logging in information into our laptop, we begin to watch the monitors for any movements. The power was turned off inside the Birdcage Theater. Notice the flashing light from the Geiger counter in the center of the room. Our electromagnetic field detector was near the lower poker area. All seemed very quiet in the old Birdcage until we noticed this orb near the stairs next to the stage. Watch for the orb in the box. And again. We placed a camera on the stairs next to the stage. Everyone had a feeling something was happening in the cribs overlooking the stage, so we aimed the camera at the first two. Suddenly, our camera went out of focus for unknown
reasons.
Now look
up in that window.
Listen as our group reacts while watching the monitors.
What happened to the camera? You're standing right there. What happened to the camera?
Yeah, it's all blanked out.
Oh, no.
Down
there? Yeah. Yeah, what's going on with that camera?
Yeah, dude, you're missing.
This camera view was pointed at the stage from the back of the room. Watch as many orbs move around the main room. Watch again in the boxes. Again, the moving orbs. Notice the red flashing light of the Geiger counter. It begins to flash many times as it picks up energy disturbances in the room.
There were 16 gunfights that killed 26 people in this building. So the tragedy did occur here, so it would make sense that this would have the energies. But also the artifacts. The artifacts were the actual things occurred. Matter of fact, even the pool table that Morgan Earp was shooting pool on when he was shot and fell over and died on the pool table is in the Birdcage Theater. The Black Mariah that took all but six people to Boot Hill sits on the backstage of the Birdcage. So not only do we have the actual happenings, we have the actual items that were involved with the killings, not only sitting on the barroom floor, but the Black Mariah sitting on the backstage that actually took them to Boot Hill, to their resting place. Boot Hill Graveyard in Tombstone was the first graveyard of the OS to acquire the name Boot Hill. It did so because predominantly, not totally, but predominantly the people buried in Boot Hills died tragic deaths with their boots on. And that was the only graveyard that Tombstone had in 1879 up till 1884. So everyone was buried there, the babies, the good ladies, but predominantly they are the tragic deaths. Our most famous, of course, is the Clantons and the McClorys that were killed at the OK Corral gunfight. Then you have China Mary. China Mary was Mrs. Alam. She was the ruler of the Chinese sector in Tombstone. She ruled with an iron fist. No Chinese worked for you, cleaned your home, did your clothes, or even sold you the opium unless China Mary said that it was okay. Mrs. Alam was quite a figure in Tombstone history. Also Marshall White, our first marshal of Tombstone that was killed by Curly Bill Brocious, lies to rest at Boot Hill Graveyard. I have not really experienced the feelings, the things that have occurred here at Boot Hill myself. I've had several employees that have told me they've smelt the cigar smoke in the gift shop, and there's been a couple of occasions where they thought there was something in the building, but it turned out to be a bird that got inside the gift shop. There's only one thing that really stands out since I've been at Boot Hill, and that is two ladies entered Boot Hill one day, probably about in their late 50s, 60s, and they went outside. The younger lady came back in and asked to speak to someone about a photograph that she had. She said that her aunt, who was outside, had taken the picture with her mother back in the 50s, and that they had always told the story about having come to Boot Hill late in the evening. They were closing. They were the only people in the graveyard. And her sister had taken her picture, and they left. They've told this story over the years many times. In the 1950s, the photographs were a lot smaller than we can get them today, with the little edges around them, you know, with a date on it. And it wasn't but about 5 years ago, one of the grandchildren had heard the story told many times, was looking at the album, and he noticed something in the picture. So he asked his grandmother, he says, "You said you've always told that you were alone in the graveyard. who is this behind you? And she said, there was no one. And she says, but maybe my memory fails. So he took the picture to a photography place, had it blown up so that he could see what was in the picture. And it was a man standing behind her. He had on a cowboy hat, a dark coat, and you could see him all the way down. You could see him perfect. There was nothing in the way. The only problem is about the kneecaps, everything after that disappeared. He had no legs. I wanted a copy of that photograph so bad for the archives, but the people have not gotten back in touch with me, so we've lost that. What made this story even more interesting was it wasn't but just 6 months later, a gentleman walked into Boot Hill, and he says, I would like to talk to someone about a picture I took in the graveyard. And I said, I'd love to talk to you about it, sir. He pulls out a photograph, and it's a little larger, but not blown up as the ladies had had, but it's not like the 50s, 1950s photo. And he says, could you explain this to me? He says, my wife took this picture of me. It was the same position, facing the same way. I'm not sure if it was the same grave, but I recognized the background. So his back was to the same background. And he was standing by a grave, as she was. Right behind him, there was nothing. But you could see from the ground up a pair of boots and legs to the kneecap. But after that, there was nothing. I asked him also, I would give anything to have a copy of that photograph of both of them, because this would really be great for the archives of the spirits, the energies at Boot Hill Graveyard. But I haven't seen or heard from either one of these folks. I offered to pay for a copy, get their name, but I haven't heard from them. But that is the only thing that I've actually experienced myself. I really think, after being at both places, the Birdcage and Boot Hill, that Boot Hill is where they sleep during the day and they play at night in the Birdcage Theater.
Our investigation in Boot Hill was very quiet as we walked around. We did not capture any paranormal activity. With our investigations over, let's review some of the highlights of our time in Tombstone, Arizona. It was exciting. The Buford House was the place of our first investigation. We were able to film orbs in a few different rooms. Here is some of the video of orbs in motion at the Buford House. This photograph of a mirror in a downstairs bedroom revealed a few faces looking back at us. Take a look at this face. It looks like a man. Really look at the facial structure. That face is very clear. Can you see other faces? This face looks like an Indian's face wearing a wide-brimmed hat. I also see face paint on this face. Scan the photo for other faces. This looks like a woman hiding half of her face. It looks like she has some type of a headband on. Take some time and look for anything else in the mirror. The Buford House Bed and Breakfast was a very exciting investigation. Our next stop was the historic Birdcage Theater. We were able to capture a few orbs in motion while spending the night inside. The most shocking event was when one of our cameras suddenly went out of focus during the night. As suddenly as it was out of focus, it was back to normal. Our 35mm camera attempted to focus on something while no one was touching it. The same 35mm camera began snapping photos in the main hall. No one was touching the camera. Listen as the camera takes photos by itself. Here are the 16 photos in sequence. Notice the small light on the corner of the right frame, just under the cribs. That light stays in the same place for a few more photos. Something causes the autofocus to adjust, causing a blurry photo. The light has also moved. We used a Geiger counter, electromagnetic field detectors, temperature sensors, sound recording equipment, infrared video cameras, digital cameras, and 35mm cameras during this investigation. Here are a few photos of the birdcage for you to enjoy. During this investigation, many of our crew had feelings of a presence. With the readings from our equipment and our videos, I would say we experienced some very strange phenomena in the Birdcage Theater. The city of Tombstone, Arizona. With its very colorful past, we hoped to capture activity while we walked around town. We did get feelings of a presence in town, but were unsuccessful at capturing anything on video. The world-famous Boot Hill Graveyard. We were unable to capture any activity on film during our investigation. Here are some of our photos of Boot Hill. Tombstone, Arizona. The town is rich in history and definitely a great place to visit. This investigation was an extraordinary success, and we look forward to visiting again. Is Tombstone haunted? The ghost trackers have brought you evidence that something is taking place in some of Tombstone's historic locations. With our photos and videos capturing strange orbs. With our other equipment capturing disturbances of energy. The ghost trackers believe. Do you? Ghosts of Tombstone.